Well, good morning. We are live-ish. Well, we're recording. Apologies to everyone who logged into St. John's this morning to join us for worship. It would appear that Zoom feeds went out around the nation this morning, and we hope that you were able to find some different way to worship in your home this morning, either with another faith community online or by prayers and presence in your own space. Barbara and I were able to get our free Zoom feed going this morning, and so we wanted to be able to bring you her sermon and be able to mark the day with her excellent preaching. And so we'll begin with a collect. I'll read the gospel, and then Barbara will offer her sermon, and we offer it up to you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Oh God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the Gospel according to St. John. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you, and in a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." Here ends the lesson.
In the name of the Holy Spirit, who teaches us about God. The disease almost got me. It was a summer afternoon and I was 4 years old. The polio epidemic was raging as it did every summer in the late 40s and early 50s. It attacked the nervous systems of children and young adults, causing paralysis and even death. Swimming pools were closed. Parents were afraid to let their children go to movies or to church and kept them at home as much as they could. There was no cure, only treatment to help ease symptoms in something called the iron lung. I was sitting in a flowered lawn chair on the screen porch at home looking through my books, and when I tried to get up, I fell and I couldn't walk. My mother rushed into the room, felt my feverish brow, and immediately raced me to the doctor. I was put into Children's Hospital in St. Paul. I had many of the symptoms of polio. For 2 weeks, I was hospitalized as I tried to figure out if that's what I had or not. I was in a room by myself, visited every day by my mom, my dad declaring he couldn't stand to come and see me lying there. I remember very little except being sad that I could no longer be the flower girl in my aunt's upcoming wedding. My mother told me that I had to get well so that I could start kindergarten in the fall. Finally, they determined that I did not have polio, but had an allergy to the measles, which I had had recently. They did a biopsy on my left arm, and for some reason, the stitches are still there, a marking of sorts. A couple of years later, Jonas Salk developed a vaccine, and we all lined up in school to drink the vile tasting stuff out of little cups. In times of epidemics, pandemics, and national crisis, the ground shifts and earlier assumptions are no longer valid. Assumptions about safety, science, support, and sanity. It's as if things we had relied on for protection aren't there anymore. In today's gospel from John, Jesus says that he will not leave us orphaned, that is, deprived of the parental protection and identity that should define a child. The term widows and orphans appears repeatedly in Scripture as shorthand for the vulnerable, the poor, those most in need. Orphaned is also a term that is used when a disciple loses a beloved teacher. I admit to feeling orphaned some days now. When the sky is gray, the routine never varies, the fear escalates, and the questions close in. What will I do if, why can't we get some kind of timeline? What if people I love lose their jobs? What are my grandsons going to do all summer with no camps, no lakes, no pools, no soccer? Isn't it interesting how fast the defining watchword busy has all but disappeared from family life? We will not be orphaned, let alone without, with no resources, Jesus says. We will be given the Holy Spirit, which he calls the Advocate. The Spirit will be God's presence with us throughout our lives. Many of us in the church are not big on discussing the Holy Spirit. We'd rather talk about the Creator or Jesus. This discomfort may be because of how hard it is to understand this aspect of God. After hearing most explanations, I want to ask respectfully, what does that even mean? And then the follow-up questions, what does this Spirit do? And how do we access this thing if it's there at all? Good questions, right? We need to look deeply into our tradition and our hearts to answer them. First, the Holy Spirit demands that we're honest with ourselves. She is in the depth of our most honest questions and in the yearning that pours out of our hearts for meaning, for comfort, for solace, for direction. Blaise Pascal, the philosopher, said there is a God-shaped vacuum in every human heart. We can access the Spirit by not dismissing these feelings, these yearnings, or these questions. The Spirit helps us remember. Hope, Sister Joan Chittister says, is based on memory. It is fed by our collective memories recorded in Scripture, such as the prolonged journey of our ancestors, the Israelites, in memories embedded in our national history of people like Alexander Hamilton, in events like the Great Depression, or the accumulated courage and pain of sending young men and women off to war again and again. And in those times of personal crisis, when somehow, eventually, we prevailed. I'm very nostalgic lately. I went to the huge Gerton's outside garden store on Tuesday early in the morning. Usually visits to these places in the early spring are a giddy, joyful experience for me. The winter's past, the birds are singing, it's time to grow stuff. This time, it just felt sad. People seemed rushed and subdued, wearing their masks, their facial expressions not recognizable, no one laughing or joking around. On the way home, I decided to drive through the neighborhood where I grew up. I knew that my parents' old house on Curtis Street had new owners. And I smiled when I found the front yard filled with lavender phlox and red and white tulips. A dog peeked at me out the front window. I glanced at the screen porch where I spent so many hours reading, even that fateful day when another disease stalked the city and the country. Driving a few blocks to my grandparents' house on Monoman Street, I found it newly painted, the front porch where the morning glories used to climb, looking so much smaller than I remembered it. There had been so much pain in that house, joy too, but here were two little kids playing on the sidewalk. In spite of all the painful things these places held, I could only see the flowers, the colors, hear the birdsong and the children laughing. These accumulated memories may be edited by the Spirit, stimulate hope that all will be well somehow. The Spirit works through other people. The oft-quoted Barbara Brown Taylor says that when she asked, what she asked God for was a clear statement about God's existence, but what she got were other people. We may find the Spirit of God through people and what they say or do, but then try not to dismiss it because it's not in the form that we wanted it to be, because we don't like that person or had a bad experience with them. Taylor asks, how many times have I rejected love because it did not present itself the way I expected, in a form acceptable to me? Good question. The Spirit works through the natural world and the beauty that is held there. Sometimes I think nature even makes a little social commentary, as in Patricia Hample's statement about that the lilacs are immigrants. She notes that lilacs were first brought to America by 19th century Czech immigrants, and that the lilacs now seen next to a farmhouse on the prairie in Minnesota or Iowa may have been there longer than any of us have been alive. With all that immigrants had to leave behind, she says, they valued these bushes enough to make room for a cunning or two among their baggage and bundles. The lilacs are immigrant flowers brought here by people who love their beauty. They survived. The Spirit helps us understand the big picture. In her book, Learning to Walk in the Dark, Tyler talks about a period of sadness and loss in her life. She says, "But I found that if I took the trouble to put on my robe and go outside, the night sky would heal me. Not by reassuring me that everything will be fine, but by reminding me of my place in the universe. Every atom on Earth comes from the sky I'm looking at. Hydrogen, carbon, oxygen, iron, the basic building blocks of everything from the high peaks of the Himalayas to the hollow flutes of my bones. I and everything I love have come forth from the furnace of the stars by a process so full of unfathomable life-giving grace that my earlier worrying strikes me as cheap." The Spirit speaks through beauty. Like many of you, I was deeply moved by Mark McEnroy's series on this topic. No matter how orphaned we feel, no matter how far-reaching the crisis, the beautiful invites us beyond it. In fact, the Irish writer John O'Donohue says that beauty is our calling. Beauty is a witness to the Creator. And the man said to the almond tree, "Speak to me of God." And the almond tree blossomed. In fact, early spring, even this year, is the magical time of white blossoms and pink blossoms lining our street, outrageous abundance. But the Holy Spirit, like beauty, may not always remove pain, mitigate loss, or in itself give us solutions to suffering. In A River Runs Through It, unquestionably the richest, most beautiful film I know, a view shared by the rector, the story is of two brothers raised by a Methodist minister and his wife in the Missoula, Montana of the 1920s. The father and his two sons are devout fly fishermen and bond deeply with each other in the trout-filled rivers that run through the glorious landscape. The oldest brother, Norman, grows up and follows a traditional path, eventually moves away, becomes a professor, married, and has children. But the charismatic, fun-loving younger brother, Paul, remains in Missoula, becomes a newspaper man, gets into trouble with alcohol, and is murdered by thugs avenging his unpaid gambling debts. As with any family losing a child, the parents are devastated, ironically orphaned by this loss.
As time passed, my father struggled for more to hold on to, asking me again and again, had I told him everything? And finally, I said to him, maybe all I really know about Paul is that he was a fine fisherman. "You know more than that," my father said. "He was beautiful." And that was the last time we ever spoke of my brother's death. Indirectly, though, Paul was always present in my father's thoughts. I remember the last sermon I heard him give not long before his own death.
"Each one of us here today will, at one time in our lives look upon a loved one who is in need and ask the same question. We are willing to help, Lord, but what, if anything, is needed? For it is true we can seldom help those closest to us. Either we don't know what part of ourselves to give, or more often than not, the part we have to give is not wanted. And so it is those we live with and should know who elude us. But we can still love them. We can love completely without complete understanding.
There's more. Paul was beautiful. That's the memory. As a fisherman, he was perfection, graceful, skilled, one with the trout-filled streams where he was most at home. Paul was beautiful. As blonde and handsome as Norman was dark and average, as daring as Norman was cautious and anxious, as impulsive as Norman was thoughtful. Paul was fun, and his parents loved it when he entertained the family around the dinner table. But Paul placed himself beyond help, not wanting what the family could have provided, pulling away into his own world. The Reverend McLean reminds us, though, that we can love completely without complete understanding. Love each other, love our family, even love God. Complete understanding is a standard many of us have. We distrust what we can't understand. How many times have we walked right by an idea or a person or an opportunity that is not as bright and shiny and eloquent as we would like it to be? Or more importantly, because we could not completely intellectually understand it. The Holy Spirit cannot take away our pain or assuage our fear, but it can, if just for a moment, take us to a place where we know there is something more, where reason loses its hold on us and we are in the presence of something that makes us forget all the rest, and we are orphaned no longer, but part of something eternal, and for some unfathomable reason, loved as dear children of God. We may not understand this. We don't have to, because we can love and be loved completely without complete understanding. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Barbara. Let us close with a prayer provided by the Anglican Church in Scotland for times of pandemic. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of our salvation, you have ordained that we should serve you in serving one another. Look upon this state and this nation, burdened at this time with many cares and anxieties, with infection, sickness, and untimely death. Grant us grace to work together with honest and faithful hearts, each caring for the good of all, that striving first for your kingdom and its righteousness, we may have added to us all things that we need for our daily sustenance and the common good. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you for joining us for this abbreviated service and for being with us for Barbara's sermon. And we'll look forward to, God willing, next week being back on Zoom and together in spirit and in truth. Take care, have a good week, and blessings. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.